Okay. Hey. What does it mean if we say that's a solution to this inequality? What does it mean? What's that?
Zero's less than three.
If zero's less than three, it's not what it means.
And then you can just like get an answer out of zero's points.
Using okay, so this could be a point on a graph, but it's not, right now. It's just an ordered pair, just a couple of numbers, right? This one is x, and this one is y. And you plug in 0 for x and 0 for y, and then what happens? You get an answer. Any old answer?
The answer.
The answer? What kind of answer? Really, two answers, right? Two kind of answers.
Right
and wrong. Which one do you get if this is a solution?
The right answer, right?
You get something that's correct. Right? Sometimes lots of things are correct, and sometimes only one thing is correct. In this case, there's lots of numbers that are less than 3, and as long as we choose an x and a y that causes this side to be less than 3, we'll have a solution. So there's an infinite number of solutions. For an equation, that might not be true, especially the equation in one variable. So 2x minus y is less than 3. Well, if x is 0 and y is 0, will that be less than 3? Well, that's 0 and that's less than 3. So yes, it is. Yes, this is a solution. Do the same thing with 2 and negative 2. 2 times 2 for x minus negative 2. Is that less than 3? 4 plus 2 is 6. That is not less than 3. So that's not less than that, it's not less than that. So it's not, no. Right. So we could, I would prefer that you say something like, this is a solution, this one is not a solution. Okay. Well, the first one's a solution, the second one's not a solution. But to be clear, check marks and the X's, like on a quiz or a test or something like that, just say it. This is a solution, this one's not. All right. Now, what's that about? We're going to graph this inequality. How do we start that? Okay, we got to make some axes. That's a given.
You go 3.
Go to a y-intercept of 3. Up 3 and over 1. Right, because we're graphing a line here. If this were an equation, then that would be the equation for, well, when you graph it, you get a line. It would be a linear equality. It's not an equation, it's an inequality, but we can start by like acting like it is an equation and graphing it like that. Okay, so then we connect these two dots with
a dotted line,
because we don't have the equals to. I'm going to ask this question, I'm going to ask this question so many times until everybody just chimes in every time I ask it, and then we'll be like, yeah, okay, you got it. If I pick a point from on the line, I pick that point, which that point is, it has two components, an x and a y component. If I take that x and y and I put it in here, what's going to happen?
It's going to equal.
What's going to equal?
If you put one that's on the line, it's
going to equal. Yep. If I put a point that's on the line into here, the line that we made from this, right? If we put a point on the line in here, we'll get this equals that. Is that okay?
No.
Not according to this guy right here. That side needs to be less, right? Well, that side is y, right? Y, and y on a graph is vertical. We put that y thing vertical. So vertically, where do we find things that are less?
Less.
On the bottom.
On the bottom. So if we want y values that are less than the y values on this line, graph below, or we shade below. Any point in here, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, any of them, that when we plug in that x, we're going to get a y value that's less than the y value that we would, or we're going to get, let me rephrase that. We take this point in the shaded region, and we put in that x, we'll get a number, and when we look at the y values, the y that we get when we plug in this x, this y value will be less than that. Because the y value that you're going to get when you plug that x in is the one that's on the line. Okay. And the second one. Maybe similar. But you chose it because it's a little bit different, right, Tyler?
So you got to divide by 5 on all of them.
Divide by 5 first?
Yeah, by the whole 5.
2/5 x plus y less than or equal to negative 2. Subtract 2/5 on both sides. All right, now we have it. It looks like y equals mx plus b. It's easier to graph. Negative 2 is our y-intercept. Up 2 and to the left 5. That's 4, 5. Solid or dotted line?
Solid.
It's okay if we pick points on the line. So we include the line. Because if we pick it off the line, we put that x and that y, they'll be equal, which is okay by that part of the symbol. We also want to include y values that are less than the y values from points on the line. So where do we shade?
Below.
Yeah, we want y values that are less than the y values. Could if we don't like that, we could also try like take the point 0, 0. It's not on the line. We want to find out the stuff that's not on the line. Where do we shade? So either shade up here or shade down here. Take 0, 0. It's an easy one to plug in. You put 0 here, 0 here. Is 0 less than, this is 0, negative 2. Is 0 less than negative 2? No, it's not. So this can't be where we're supposed to shade. We're supposed to shade down here. Either way, you can decide either way. Okay. Any questions? Any questions from the rest of the homework?
Can you explain piecewise functions a little bit?
Okay. That's from the last homework, right?
I think so.
But it's relevant because we're going to take a quiz. So, real quickly, well, let's get the homework in. We'll turn that in. And then I'll talk about piecewise functions. Make sure I don't forget. I like that.
Can I ask a question about the horn before we turn it in?
Hold on to your homeworks for a second. Chance had a question that I kind of inadvertently just stepped on. What was your question?
Number 33.
33. 3y less than 4.5x plus 15. Okay, so we're going to graph this. It's going to be similar to all the other ones we've graphed, those two that we graphed a second ago. Where do we start?
3y.
3y?
Yeah. 3.
Just 3.
Divide by 3. Divide this side by 3.
So y is less than, so you gotta divide this by 3 and this by 3. 15 divided by 3 is 5. 4.5 divided by 3, I'm sure you can pull out your calculator and do that. But hold on, wait a minute. But if we multiply 4.5 by 1/3, that's the same, isn't it? Okay. 4.5 is 4 and 1/2, 4 plus 1/2 more. Times a third, turn this into an improper fraction. We get 9/2 times 1/3. We get cross cancellation. So 3/2. 3/2 x plus 5.
What did you just do?
What did I just do? I took, we're going to divide 4.5 by 3. We did 15 divided by 3, that's done. 4.5 divided by 3, 4.5 divided by 3, that's the same as 4.5 times 1/3.
Okay.
I wrote 4.5 is a fraction instead of a decimal, 4.5. Right? Turned it into an improper fraction. Right? This is 8/2 plus 1/2, 9/2. And then multiplied together, cross cancel. Okay. 3/2 times So we'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's say down 3 and to the left 2. Dotted line. And shade where?
Down.
Shade down. Down below. Less. Okay, are there any other ones? Any other questions? It's right there, it's fine. Okay, now let's start our homework, and then we'll go over these white squares. Right. A function is something that you put stuff into and stuff comes out. Simple as that. Okay. And usually it's pretty straightforward. Something like y equals 2x plus 2. Well, if I want to figure out what y is when x is 2, I plug in 2. Or if I want to figure out what y is when x is 3, I plug in 3. I do the math. And there it is. There's the output. Right? That's how the input-output thing works. We put stuff in for x and calculate what y would be. And typically, it's just anything goes, right? So whatever the x value is, just plug it into the function, and away you go. A piecewise function works a little differently. We want to use this, say, for example, this function sometimes, and another function other times. Okay. So we'll use this function if x is less than or equal to negative 2. Okay. So that's what that little comma means. Well, we'll use that function if x is less than or equal to negative 2. So can we put in negative 3 into that function? Yeah. Why? It's less than negative 2. Can we put in negative 5? Yeah, can we put in 0?
No.
No, because that's bigger than negative 2, okay? So if we left it like that, then there'd be nothing we could do. We just wouldn't have, like, the domain wouldn't go past negative 2. But if we then say, well, when x is greater than 2, then use this function. Okay. Use that function when x is, when you get bigger than negative 2. Sorry, not 2, negative 2. Okay. And then we group them all together with this left brace or squiggly bracket, whatever you want to call it. And we say, that together is y. Okay? So let's not call it y. We'll just call it f of x. So what does this mean? What does this notation mean? F of 3, that's how we read it? And what's the definition of it? What are we doing here?
Multiplying.
No, it's not multiplying. We're not multiplying f times 3. Yes?
X equals 3.
X equals 3 in the function called f. Okay, so we substitute 3 for x. Does anyone put it in both of these? You get two answers?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that wouldn't be a function, would it? You have to get only one output when you have a function. So how do we decide?
Well, it's greater than negative 2, so.
Greater than negative 2, so we use this one. So 3 halves times 3 minus 7. We get 9 halves minus 7. So let's see, that's
1 half
minus 7. Negative 2 and a half? Negative 3 halves? No. Yeah? Yeah. No.
That would be negative 2 and a half.
Negative negative 2.5, so negative 5.5.
Yeah.
I even said that. Just did it wrong. Okay, negative 5.5.
Okay, it makes sense now.
Okay, good. Yeah.
Why do you use the 3.5 x minus 7?
Like, right here, like, why did I plug it in there?
Like,
no, right, yeah.
If x is bigger than negative 2,
yeah,
then why do you use 3 over 2 x minus 7?
Why?
Yeah.
Would it be sufficient just to say the problem says 2? Well, because, like, are you asking for...
See, we don't understand why we're using minus 7.
Yeah, would we just... Can we plug in anything like minus 8? How do you get 7?
Oh, I made it up.
Oh.
Cool. I just made it up.
Okay.
So all this is completely made up from me, from my brain.
Okay.
Okay? There's no reason why this function is the function that it is, or this one is the one that it is. Like, this is not decided by that. Okay? I can choose any functions I want, and then make any rules I want about when to use them. Yeah?
So for the, like, f
of
x?
No, no, no.
What?
F of x.
F of x. Why did you put 3 in there? When you...
I made that up too. I decided 3 was going to go into the function. Okay? So I made this up, made up this problem to explain what a piecewise function is. I made up a piecewise function out of my imagination, and then I made up an example to show you like how the piecewise function that I made up gets used. Okay? That's a common question I get, like, why did you do that? They don't realize I just made it up. That's all I have to say about that. Okay? Is that good? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Chance? What are you confused about, Chance?
I don't understand the question, like what you're trying to get at.
Well, Tyler just asked, can we talk about piecewise functions? Right. So I made up a piecewise function so that we could talk about a piecewise function. And the thing I'm trying to explain about piecewise functions is that they're pieced together. They're like Frankenstein together with different pieces of different functions. We stitch them all together, and the seams, where they meet together, is here. When x is less than or equal to negative 2, you're going to use 2x plus 2 as your function to get your output. If x is bigger than 2, or sorry, negative 2, if x is bigger than negative 2, then we'll use this function to get our output. No matter what.
We'll use that one of those two functions.
Yes, we'll use one of those two functions no matter what. You know, in this case, when we go to a different problem, that'll be different. But in this case, one of those two functions is going to get used. We just have to decide which one. We decide which one by which x value we're putting into the function.
Works out so, right?
I'm gonna graph this, so I want to make sure that we're clear on this concept.
Even the chance to
think. If you use a number like negative 3, you'd have to use the top one, right? Because it's less.
Right.
Than
yeah.
Maybe that would help. So f of negative 3, well then this would need to go in here. That's a lot of squiggling around. You'd have to go in there.
Yeah.
Why? Does negative 3 have to go in there rather than in here?
Because negative 3.
Because it's decided by the value of this number. This is the number that's going to go in for x. Okay, so x is negative 3 right now. Well, x being negative 3, that x is less than negative 2. So we need to use this function.
Can we graph this one and then do one more?
By graph, do you mean just find the number?
Like, yeah, I just finish it.
Okay. Well, that's it. Not to pick on you. That's not graphing. I want to graph this function on a graph, but I didn't want to move on until like just the idea of putting stuff into the function made sense.
Yeah, that's just what I wanted. That's what I wanted to see, like another one and see like maybe.
Okay.
This might make more sense on like a clean slate.
So since negative 3 is less than negative 2, we're going to use this function. So we're going to put negative 3 in there. So 2 times negative 3 plus 2 That's negative 6 plus 2 is negative 4. So negative 4 is our output when x is the input, or when negative 3 is the input. Okay. We go on like this forever, just making up inputs, right? If we did 0, f of 0. Okay. Well, this means put 0 in for x, where you see the function f. Okay. Then we look at f and we realize it's made of two different functions, so which one do we put it into? Bottom one, because 0, right, x is 0 now, 0 is greater than negative 2. Okay? So 3 halves times 0 minus 7 equals negative 7. See, sometimes we're using the 3 halves x minus 7, and sometimes we're using the 2x plus 2. It all is determined by these guys right here. Whenever you have an x that's less than or equal to negative 2, put it in there. Whenever you have an x that's greater than negative 2, put it in there. Is that how Keenan? Chance? There's a weird thing to do to make a function like that. But there it is anyway. Okay, let's look at the graph of this function. Okay. The graph of this function is going to be just like this function itself has as an equation. Is made up of two equations, two functions. The graph is going to be like the putting together of two graphs, right? This is the Frankensteining of two equations. This is the Frankensteining of two graphs. But of course it would be that, because when we graph a function, we're just graphing all the solutions to that function, all the points on the graph. If we take a point off of there and we put it into the function, we get something that's true. The side is equal to that side. So, when x is less than negative 2, we're going to use that function. We're going to graph that function. So we should go to x is negative 2, and maybe put a dotted line to help ourselves out. That is, that's the boundary. That's the breaking point. On the left, we're going to use one function, and on the right, we're going to use the other. Where x is less than negative 2, we're going to use this function, and where x is greater than negative 2, that'd be over here, this direction. We're going to use this function. So like all the stuff we've been talking about and deciding which function to use, all this, this is just a graphical representation of that, of what we've been saying. When we have x values that are over here, we're going to use that function. Okay. So we can graph that function as just a line, right? Y-intercept of 2. Okay, now keep in mind, I'm graphing this function right now. But I'm only supposed to graph this function when x is less than or equal to negative 2. But to get that graph, it's easiest to go to the y-axis for the y-intercept. Okay. Now, I shouldn't draw this graph over here because it's for when x is less than negative 2, not bigger than negative 2. Okay. So I'll just use it as a guide, help it, you know, have it help me get over here, and then graph the rest of it over there. So I have a slope of 2. I go down 2 and over 1, down another 2. And over 1, and that gets us into the place where we actually start graphing it. Okay? We'll put a little dot right there. And this dot will be filled in. Why is this dot filled in?
Greater than or equal to.
Less than or equal to.
Or less than, yeah.
X is less than or equal to negative 2, so when x is negative 2, we use this function. And when x is negative 2, this function is worth negative 2. When x is negative 2, how am I doing this wrong? Okay, we can do the slope again, down 2 and over 1, and graph it like that. So this is the function that tells you your outputs when your x is less than or equal to negative 2. On the graph, x is less than or equal to negative 2 to the left of negative 2 and at negative 2. And so we graph that function to the left of negative 2. To the right, when x is greater than negative 2, we're going to use this function. We're going to graph this function. 5, 6, 7. Negative 7 is our y-intercept. And our slope is 3 halves, so up 1, 2, 3, and over 2. Or you can come over here, and then 1, 2, 3, and over 2. Okay, just going to put a little point right there. So when I get to negative 2, which function am I supposed to use? The top one, this one, the one that makes this graph. Not this graph over here. Right, so that's why here we put an open circle, just to let us know. Jump up to here and use this graph when we're at negative 2. And then we just connect all these points, and those are, those together are the graph of that piecewise function. Okay. Also, I have these. Pass these out. Just take one and pass it down. This isn't the quiz, it's just a preview of the kinds of questions you'll see on the quiz today. We're taking it today, right? After we're done asking questions, we're taking the quiz. So this is just something for you to look at, and maybe if you're reminded, oh yeah, I forgot about that stuff, how do you do that? Right? So,
write on
them? Yeah, you can have them, you can write on them. I'm not intending you to take it, because there's lots of questions and that would take a long time. I'm intending you to take a look at it. Look at the ones like, oh, I can do that, I can graph that, oh, but I forgot how to, you know, write an equation or something like that. So if nobody speaks up and asks questions, I'm going to have you put those away, and I'll pass out the real quiz. Yeah, Daniel.
Can we go over, like, number 26?
Yes. So the absolute value of x, the graph of y equals the absolute value of x, looks like this. And then we can do things like multiply that absolute value by something, or add something to it, or add something to x before we take the absolute value. And those all had effects on the graph. If you don't remember that, then you should go back and watch the video about that. Or come in and see me one on one, we'll talk about it. But if you remember, like, what did multiplying it by a do? How did a affect this graph? How did it, you know, how did the graph of something times the absolute value of x compared to just absolute value of x?
It increased the slope.
Yes. It changes the slope, right? It increased the slope if a is like 2 or 3. But if it's like 1 half or 3 fourths or something like that, then it'll make it less steep. So it changes the steepness. What about this? What did this do? Putting a negative there.
Changes whether it goes above the x-axis than below the x-axis.
It makes everything above the x-axis go below the x-axis?
Yeah.
Yeah, everything, all those positive values become negative values. Yeah, so it flips it over. it flips the graph vertically. This graph, right?
Yeah.
If you took this graph and put a negative in front of there, that would get flipped over. Okay. What about this? What is adding something or subtracting something to x inside the absolute value do?
Makes it positive.
positive or negative on the x-axis? What do you mean by that?
Well, if it's minus h, then it goes to the right.
Right. It moves it horizontally. Moves right, h. And the reason I put right is, if h is positive, then you're subtracting, and it's just what you said, you move to the right. But if h is negative, you subtract the negative, which is would look like adding, right? Then if you move right a negative amount, that means you'd move left, right? Correct? Okay. So if we're subtracting something, we move to the right. If we add something, we move to the left. And then what does this guy do? Moves it up and out. Okay? Right. Add k. If k is positive, it goes up. And if k is negative, it goes down. Okay, so we come over here. Well, we have a plus 5. What's that going to do to the graph?
It's going to go up.
It's going to make it go up 5. How about this guy?
Left 5.
Left 5. And this guy?
Below the axis, backslash.
It's going to flip it. Flip. Flip over its vertex. Right? The vertex is that pointy thing right there. Yeah, and there's the vertex. So we'll move it up 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, to the left 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right there's our vertex. Okay. The slope is the same, it's still 1 for 1. Down 1, over 1, down 1, over 1. It's flipped downward because of that negative. Okay, what's the next one?
16.
Okay. The first thing that it says is that x and y vary directly. It's an invaluable piece of information. If we didn't know that, we couldn't do this problem. Right? Without that, it would say y equals negative 8 when x equals 5. Like, that could be any number of equations. I could write tons of different kinds of equations that would turn a specific x is 5 into y is negative 8. So what does it mean that y and x vary directly?
Y equals ax.
When we say y and x vary directly, this is it. You look it up in the dictionary, under direct variation, it tells you it's a noun, and then it just has this equation. That's what it means. Okay? Y equals ax. So you get y by taking x and multiplying it by a constant a. So if you were to finish this equation, you would need to know what a is. What's that? Once you knew what a was, you knew that a was 5 or a was 7 or whatever, you're done. You plug it into a and you have written. Okay, so we look in here, and it tells us that A is equal to, does it tell us that? So how do we figure out what A is? Don't know what A is. How do we figure out what A is? What's that? You do have some numbers. You have an X and you have a Y. So we could plug in X and Y, and then A would be the only thing that we don't know, and we can always solve for one variable in an equation like that. So y is negative 8. That's equal to whatever that a is times 5. So if we divide both sides by 5, negative 8 fifths is a. We put that right in there. We get y is equal to negative 8 fifths times x. That should be equal to a. Next. And we discovered last class that these numbers are off. Okay. Let me prepare you right now as I write these down. Participate in in this solving this problem or participate in long, long, awkward silences. Okay? I will be waiting and waiting and waiting for you to give me some input. Okay? But what I'll start you off with is just to remind you, I'm looking for a rule, an equation, that, you know, on one side, we're not sure what it's going to be. It's going to have x in it. Maybe it'll have x in there multiple times. It depends on what we decide to do. But whatever it is, we should be able to take these x's, and I did change that 24 to a negative 4. We should be able to take these x's, whatever they are, plug them in here, do the math, and come out with y.
So that 24 was wrong, right?
Yeah.
So
I don't know why it was that. That's when the computer designs, puts those numbers in there automatically. And this is what we have to figure out, all this stuff over here. What do we have to do to x? Do we multiply it by something? Do we add something to it? Do we do both of those things? Do we divide? What do we do? And the thing that I will say is absolutely the worst way to do it is to do nothing. Sit there and stare at it and say, I don't know how to do this. Okay? Write some kind of an equation that makes some kind of sense and seems like it takes this x and turns it into y. Most likely your first guess is going to be wrong. So, figure out why it's wrong and fix it. So that's it. Now it's time for awkward silences until you suggest something. Tyler?
7 1/4 times x.
7 1/4?
7 1/4.
7 1/4.
And times x.
Times x. That's it?
Yeah.
Okay. 7 1/4 times x. So 7, let's turn that into a proper fraction, and 29 fourths times x, okay? So, the way we'll test it, we have no idea if it's working, we'll plug in some x's and see what it's getting us. It might be helpful to create a little table to see what's going on here. Okay. So the first thing we're supposed to be able to put in is negative 4. We put in negative 4 into here. Negative 4 times 29 over 4, well, that's going to cancel the 4 and the 4, but we're going to have a negative 1 here. So 29 times negative 1, negative 29. That didn't give us the right thing, right? Let's see what the next one gives us. We're just plugging a 0. 29 fourths times 0 gives you 0. If we put a 4 in there, well, it'll be very similar to the negative 4. We'll just get positive 29. So it looks like just multiplying this number by something, it's not going to quite get it done. Like, if we did it this way, y equals ax, right? It'd have to be direct variation. And even if we change this to a negative, so that this is a positive 29 to start off with. Still, we're going to get 0, and this will be negative 29. So direct variation doesn't seem the way to go, because we found the one to multiply negative 4 by to get 29, but it doesn't work for 0 or 4. So, you know, we can like cross something off of our list. Direct variation? No, it's not. It's not going to be just a number times x, but that's useful. Know that it's not just that. But that multiplying the number a number times x might be part of it. We might just have to do some more. Still working on number two. The sentences are long and they are taking away from your quiz time. Yeah?
You can find the y-intercept by looking at the graph.
Well, I guess you could, but then you'd be assuming that it would make a line. Do you know that for sure?
Well, it says to express your answer in slope-intercept form.
Okay. So if that's part of the question, or yeah, if that's part of the question, then that would be a line. So what's your y-intercept then?
28, because x is 0.
Okay, 0 comma 28, that's the definition of a y-intercept, plus 28. Well, it's slope-intercept form, what are we missing?
M.
How can we find the M slope?
Take two points?
Mm-hmm. Like, how about this one and this one? 0 is nice, positive is good too. Okay? So, how do we do that?
4 minus 0.
7 minus.
Are you just saying numbers?
Over.
4 minus 0 over that? 4 minus 0.
No. That's x's over y.
Oh, we need the change in y over the change in x. So 4 minus 0. 4 minus 0. So 27 minus 8. 27 minus 8 over 4 minus 0. So 9.
What do you mean 28?
Oh, I don't know why I have 8. 27 minus 28 is negative 1. 4 minus 0 is 4. Negative 1 fourth. Negative 1 fourth x. Given the information that it needed to be in slope-intercept form, tells us it's linear, tells us we just need a y-intercept and a slope. So just picking apart that information.
So, Mr. Smith.
Yes?
So, when all of those, you can just multiply by negative 1 fourth, and you'll get y.
On what now?
No.
Well, not just that, not just multiply by negative 1 fourth, but then add 28 after that. Number 4, I think Cody said. Find the slope of the line that goes through negative 3, negative 5. 6, negative 2. We just did this on the previous problem to find the slope. y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1.
In the wrong direction.
So negative 2, negative 2 minus negative 5. 6 minus negative 3. So negative 2 plus 5 is 3. Over 6 plus 3 is 9. 1/3. What's next?
22.
Done this back here. Right there. We ask the question, what does adding and subtracting a number to x do? Moves it left and right. What does adding something outside the absolute value do? Moves it up and down. They call them A and B, we're calling them H and K, it's all the same thing.
That be the same as in the answer section 22 to the very last page.
Given I guess four different examples. When A is positive and B is positive, when A is negative and B is positive, when A is negative and B is negative, and then Positive, negative, and negative, yeah. So that's what that's just this as a sample answer, right? Because it's written, you have to decide how to answer something like that.
Give me a number time.
9.
Yes, folks.
It says choose the equation, well, it should say write the equation of the line that is parallel to the given line and passes through the given point. Okay? So it's parallel to this line, the given line, and it goes through this point. I write the equation of line, y equals x plus b is the most convenient form, usually. So we need to figure out a way to solve for b and to solve for m. Can we figure out it, either of those things right now?
Yeah.
What? Figure out what?
The m.
The m, how can we figure out what m is?
Well, if the two lines are parallel, they have the same slope.
Okay, so this line that goes through this point is parallel to this line. This line has a slope of 3. Their parallel means that they have the same slope. So we have 3 for m. What else can we now figure out how to do?
To find b, you can take 0 and negative 2 and substitute them for y and x.
So you can put this one there and this one there. There we go. So negative 2 equals 3 times 0 plus b. We solve for b. B is negative 2. So y equals 3x minus 2.
Okay, how would you set up number 7?
Well, it's going to be a heck of a lot like this problem. Because what they're told, what you're told there is that it goes through negative 2, 3, that right here, and then they just tell you that the slope is 3. Here they told you it's actually the same exact information about the slope. They just disguise it as saying it's parallel to some other line. Now they just come out and tell you the slope is 3, and so now when we try to figure out what this equation is, we have m, we have an x to use, and we have a y to use. So negative 2 equals 3 times, or sorry,
3.
What did I go? I mixed them up because I'm in W. This should go right there. Three equals 3, the slope, times negative 2, plus b. This is negative 6, this is 3, add 6 to both sides to cancel out that negative 6, and we get 9 as b, so y equals 3x plus 9. These? You're just gonna throw them away or something? Maybe you can just give them back to me? But you're welcome to hold on to them for your own notes and such. Whatever the case is, let's get them off the desks, get everything else off the desks, and we'll get started here in a second.